grace and mercy and peace from God our Father and from our Lord Jesus. Amen. The text is from the gospel lesson in Matthew 25. For I will be like a man going on a journey who called his servants and entrusted to them his property. The text. Several weeks ago, Orphan Grain Train donated 5,000 pounds of meat to the seminarians in St. Louis. 20 pounds for each student, 20 pounds for each faculty member. Over 200 students and faculty. My brother and I, in our pickups with the wives along, took that to St. Louis. Took us a couple hours to unload all that meat, some beef, some pork. During that time, had very nice conversations with students and faculty. Whenever I'm with students, I always think back on my own times in the seminary. And one of the things that we talk about, and every student talks about, is especially first-year students, how are you doing in Greek? Greek is a challenge, but it's important because it gives a pastor a front row seat on what the original word really says. The word entrusted in the text for today. Handed over to them lock, stock, and barrel for use as they saw fit. So we talked, had plenty of time to talk because I didn't do much lifting, I did mostly advising in the unloading of the meat. And these young seminarians are strong, youthful, ambitious, some pretty clever, some pretty smart. We began talking about what are the essentials, what are the things that the professors are really drilling into you. And of course, one of the things that came up was the fundamental learning device of interpreting Scripture, and that is that Scripture interprets Scripture. If you run into difficult passages, keep perusing the book until you come to passages that speak to that difficulty. And that will usually clear it up. We did it this morning in Bible class. We're in Acts and we're in Ezekiel. We're in Acts, we're in 1 Timothy. In order to compare notes, in order to learn the full picture, in order to have knowledge that accrues to wisdom. Another thing that came up in our conversations, these students talked very cordially and usually very well informed. Even first-year students, they're very tenacious, very interested, actually very lovely young men. Some women also there who are learning to be deaconesses, they're also very gracious. Wives came with their coaster wagons and their little baby buggies to push this huge package of meat home. We began talking about how then else do you interpret Scripture? And the subject came up of context. What is the context in which this parable is told? What's Jesus doing before, during, and after? And we began talking about this. And of course, the context this morning is Jesus is walking with his disciples for the very last journey up to Jerusalem where he will be crucified. Now, today is the second to the last Sunday in the church year. And you'll notice that the texts are always about end times, about what will be the conclusion of the matter. You heard it in the epistle that we must all give an account before the judgment seat of Christ. And so we begin thinking about the end of the world. And the end of our own lives, huh? I think about that sometimes. At my age, we begin thinking about those things, don't we? And how will that be? Paul says, for me to live is Christ, and to die is gain. Is that for me too? Is that for you too? To live is Christ, to die is gain. Can I adopt that into my small brain and make it part of my living so I live anticipatorily? I live with great hope, great anticipation, that if my heart quits, my spirit doesn't. So Jesus is talking about these things going up to Jerusalem, and we read in Luke that there's another similar story that he tells. It's about a king going off to claim his kingdom and how the servants deceive him while he's gone. It's actually a very similar story. This story, Jesus is walking through Jericho. He sees Zacchaeus up in the tree. He's a little short guy. And he's up in a tree so he can hear and see. And he says to Zacchaeus, 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 come down. I'm coming to your house today. Anybody ever invite yourself to somebody's house? Do you? I did that once. And I did it on the phone. I said, by the way, my wife and I are coming to your house this Sunday. And she said, oh, you are? Then she got busy with her kinfolk, prepared dinner. It was all very nice. But you imagine the surprise of Zacchaeus' wife. She says, guess what? That guy that's getting all the attention, he's coming to our house. And I'm a tax collector and a Jew. Whoa, I wonder how that's going to turn out. Then on the way up, James and John and their mother are all postulating for who's going to be vice president? Who's going to be secretary of state? It's always a disappointment to me to hear these things because this is the last of the journey to the cross. And these disciples have been with him for 3 years, are still thinking this is going to be an earthly kingdom like a Herod. What? Don't they get it at this last stage? No, they don't. And they don't get it until after the resurrection. This is after the resurrection. Do we get it? What is the kingdom of God? It is God among us, present here now, anticipating our life forever with him. So on the way up, Jesus is telling a story. There was a man going on a journey. Behold, the man is him. He's the one going on a journey. He is the king. He's going on a journey and he's entrusting his wealth to his servants. And who are they? They are us. Is that us or we? They are we? Help me out here. They're us? Okay, they're us. So he decides to give his servants some talents. Now, a talent in those days was a 75-pound weight of money, usually gold. I did the math. 75 pounds. How many ounces per pound? This should not be a difficult question. You're allowed to talk back. How many ounces per pound? Thank you. Times 75. Times last year's 2023 average value of gold of 2,000. This guy is a wealthy guy. You know what he gave to the guy with five talents? He gave him $12,738. Said, look after it. Let it earn. To the second, he gave two talents. Being translated in today's money and its equivalent to them, $5,095,200. And he gave to the third one talent, 2,547,500. Now, if I got that kind of money, I can do something with it. I also did one other calculation. If you put $1,000 with a bank or with a stock or a bond at 7%, how long does it take to double? Who said? That's right. At 7%, your money doubles every 7 years. We don't know how long this rich fellow was gone, nor do we know how long Jesus will be gone. But he's coming back. The other meaning of talent is not weight of money. It is gift that he gives to each of us, at least one. When Jesus ascended on high, he gave gifts to men, at least one to each. The ascension was the trigger. Your baptism was the trigger. And what are these gifts? And as I look over here, I can almost tell you what your gift is, because I've been watching you for quite a few years now. Here's just a few of the gifts. Prophesying, capable of holding up the truth of God before the people in such a way that even little kids can understand it. Propheta, prophesy. Serving, that means willing to get down and be a servant. A doulos, a slave of the Lord. Encouragement, man, can we use this? Have you ever noticed your kids when you give them a pat on the back, a little attaboy? I do it downstairs sometimes. I do it in confirmation class. You do it to me too, by the way. This whole pastor's appreciation. You get cards saying you're wonderful. You begin thinking maybe you are. That's called encouraging. I think if there's one gift that's really needful for our people, for our nation right now, is a little attaboy. Good work, young woman. You're doing so good. How's school going? I'm struggling. You're trying. Good for you. Contributing. Man gave us $30,000 last week to do whatever he want with it. And he was laughing when he gave it to us at Grain Drain. Contributing, the word is giving with hilarios. You're giggling while you give the money. Now I'm going to tell you how not to do it. You know, we got that basket for donuts downstairs. I walked along, and last night I thought it was a 50 I had, but maybe it was a 20. I don't remember. It was a bigger bill than I wanted to give for the donuts. That's back when I was still eating those chocolate-covered donuts. Not so good. Anyway, I was walking past, there was somebody watching, and all I had in my billfold was a 20 or a 50, I don't recall. But I recall my right hand was clamping down on the bill so hard that I had to tug it out from between my fingers to put it in the basket with my left hand. That's not giving with hilarity. It's giving with hesitation. Giving with hilarity means I joyfully do it. And by the way, is God going to be less or more if we give or we don't give? Why do we give? Because it's good for us to give. It's good for the church. It's good for the kingdom. It's good for our neighbor. We don't make God greater or less when we give. He's great already. He owns it. He owns the geography of the universe, and he built you and me, stitch by stitch, crochet hook by crochet hook, and he still preserves us. Hospitality, prayer, promoting harmony, showing mercy. Every one of you has at least one of those gifts. And now, how do they become more? How do they become stronger? This talent is weight of money, but it's also weight of your gift that the Lord gives to you. These kinds of things. Things that help other people. And do good to yourself in the meantime. My father had a heart attack in 1947. We're still living in Mitchell, South Dakota. In those days, a severe heart attack meant shut it down. His doctor told him, "My prescription for you, Raymond, is that you do nothing for 3 months." "Can I go fishing?" "Yes." So we rented a cabin at Spirit Lake, about 80 miles north of Mequon, Wisconsin, and we fished for 3 months. And my brother and my job, he was 7, I was 8, was to row my dad around that lake in a 14-foot wooden boat with wooden oars while he fished out of the back with a rod and reel and a daredevil for Northerns. After we'd done that for about a week or so, he bought us 2 cane poles because he didn't trust us with a rod and reel. And we tied about 30 foot of string on the cane poles, put a daredevil on the end, lashed it to the bow, and that's how we trolled. And as the summer went on, we got synchronized. Before that, we were rowing in circles. I mean, we didn't know how to row worth a hoot. Once we got onto it, I was on the right oar, he was on the left. We could pull in syncopated harmony. And the boat went faster. And as the boat went faster, we caught bigger fish. And we rowed and we rowed for 3 months. And we got good at it. And we got stronger. And we caught bigger fish. And we got stronger. And only the big Northerns could catch us. I remember laying one in the sink that was caught this far from shore. Now we caught big fish, because it takes a big fish to catch you when you're really rowing fast. Are you rowing fast? Are you using your gift? Are you getting better and better every day? To some, the one he gave 5 talents and said, "Put it to work." To another, he gave 2 talents and said, "Put it to work." To another, he gave 1 talent and he buried it in the ground. Amen. Peace of God that passes our understanding, keep our hearts above ground. Amen.